Been excellent weather. He has let the sun shine, but we know that the Son of God is always shining. Let me put my corny line in. And Lord, we are just so grateful. God has been faithful to allow us another day, but not just another day, a day where we can be victorious, a day where we know that victory is promised to us, a day that we know we are more than conquerors, a day where we know that Christ always leads us in a triumphant procession, the day that we know the Lord has made, a day where we know we are in His hand, and that Jesus, our Father, and our Father is holding us in His hand, and nothing can get to us. As Jesus promised, we are grateful to know that anything that we go through,
yes,
first goes through Him, and that all things we experienced, He has experienced. Because the Bible says we have a high priest that is familiar with our sufferings. He's familiar with our concerns, and we are to cast all our cares to Him because He cares for us. God, what a faithful God you are. You are always faithful. You always remain true to your promises, and you never lie. You never fail. You can never deny yourself. In your holiness, Lord, we know that you will never sin against us, but you are righteous in all your ways, and that alone is worth our trust.
Yes.
Then we can think back over our lives, of all the things you have done, of all the ways you have made, of all the protection, of the light, of the uplifting from depression, of the healing from pain and illness, of the deliverance from bondage and oppression, of the joy and comfort in sorrow.
Yes.
How you replace our garment of heaviness with a garment of praise. You are so, so good, God. It's because of your mercy, Lord, that we are not consumed.
Yes.
You don't repay us for all that we have done, God. And I thank you because we know the wages of sin is death. Yet here we stand alive in Christ, who died and took on that punishment for us and still is alive today to intercede for us time and time again. Thank you for looking upon us through the scars of our Savior. Thank you that even the scars that we incur in this life is proof of the suffering with Him that will lead to us being glorified with you.
Yes.
Lord, we just want to thank you today. We just want to praise you. We want to glorify your name, Lord. We want to bless and honor and magnify you because your name is so much greater. Calling on the name of Jesus in the time of trouble, it causes the demons to tremble. It allows for darkness to flee. It shines a light that darkness cannot overcome.
Yes.
Lord Jesus, your name is power. Your name is strength. You are a strong tower, and the righteous run into it and are saved.
Yes.
Lord God, we lift you today as you are Lord. We cry out to you as you are our Savior. You are the King of glory, and you come and fill this place and the places of our hearts and the places of our minds and the places of our fears and our doubts and our concerns. And you just bring in that blessed assurance, Lord, that you are with us, never to leave, never to forsake us, that you are the God who sees, Jehovah El Roy, that you are the good shepherd, El Rohi. You are Jehovah Rapha, our healer. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. You are Jehovah Mapalti, the Lord, our deliverer. You are, O God, our righteousness.
Yes.
And I thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, as we come together on one accord, thank you for my brothers and sisters today. Thank you for making that way for us to come into your holy presence where there is fullness of joy. Even today, we ask that you would allow us to experience that joy, Lord God. That anything that exalts itself above that joy, that any imagination or thought that will lead us into destruction or despair, that it will be taken captive and made to obey the word of God that you are bringing forth. Lord, I ask that you will cleanse us today. You are a faithful God that forgives every sin. Forgive us, Lord God, for our trespasses, and give us that heart and willingness to forgive those who have trespassed against us. As we give all our cares to you, as we give all of our mind, our heart, our soul, and our strength to you, to love you. Teach us today, Lord God, how to love you as you desire. Teach us today how to see ourselves as you see us. Teach us today how to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And teach us today great and awesome things from your holy word. And reveal to us that plan that you have for us before the foundations of the earth. Allow us to be one with you and abide ever present with you in your presence. Bless those who are not able to attend in the house but are watching online. Right now is the time that we can think of those that we wish were with us, those that we would love to see rejoicing in the glory of the Lord, those who may not know, Lord God, those who we've been trying to get to, those who might be sick and shut in, those who might have fallen away. Lord God, we lift them up to you right now, Lord, because we know you see, we know you hear the cries of the righteous. We know that the effectual, fervent prayers of the righteous avail much. We are praying right now for those, Lord God, interceding, that you would make a difference right now, Lord God, in their situations. Bless us with your presence now, God, as we uplift you and magnify you, the Lord of angel armies, in Jesus' name. If you agree, say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Welcome, everybody. And those of you, your brothers and sisters, this is your home. It's good to see you all today. Yes, God, let us partake of the table that is spread of the bread of life today. We just want to lift up some songs of worship. Amen. I'm going to be turning it over to our sister Anita, our worship leader this morning.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we just take 30 seconds to just give God praise? Can we take 30 seconds to give him worship? Hallelujah. Can we put our hands together for the Lord of Lords and for the King of Kings? Hallelujah. The God who woke you up this morning, the God who made sure that you made it here safe and sound. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You didn't have to be here, but he made it that you are. Hallelujah. You have breath in your body. Hallelujah. He has you here in your right mind. Hallelujah. So at all times, we want to make sure that we give God total reverence. Hallelujah. For he's a great and awesome Father. He's a great and awesome Savior. Hallelujah. I can't think of a time where God wasn't there for me. Hallelujah. He has always been there for me, even when I wasn't giving him recognition. Hallelujah. 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 So, how many of you are excited to give praise and worship to the Lord our God?
Yes, I am. He's worthy.
I'm very excited. I'm always excited. Sometimes I catch myself playing gospel music in the car at an intersection, and I get the look over like, there's nothing more beautiful than being able to not only share the gospel of the word, but being able to worship in song as well, if that's your thing. And for me, that is definitely my thing. Song is how I communicate with God the best way that I know how. And it just brings me great joy to be able to fellowship with everybody. You don't have to be the best singer at all. I remember one point in time, I couldn't carry a note.
So we got some singers in the audience.
Yes, we do. Oh, yeah, we do. So I just want us to get into the mode. Let's worship God. Let's give him praise. Let's give him worship. And let's just have a good time. Worship is about freedom of expression. It's about enjoying giving God praise. Hallelujah. Don't feel that you have to box in your praise. No, God doesn't want that from you. God wants you to worship him freely, willingly, and lovingly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say now. I just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory. I just wanna praise you forever and ever for all that he does for you, everything that he does for you. Us, oh God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the desire to just praise you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you for the hearts and minds that are centered on you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you for blessing us. Hallelujah. Because all of us know that our stories could have been another way, but God did that. God made it so that we're here today being able to give him honor and give him glory. So we just thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 All right. So this next song is God Almighty. I know everybody here knows it, and even if you don't know it, sing along anyway. Hallelujah.
It's easy.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, God. No ads.
Hallelujah. Oh. Oh.
Sing praises to the King, all the glory.
Worship you, Lord. God, we just, we love you, Lord. We love you today, tomorrow, and always, God. And we are ever so thankful to just be able to praise you, God, to lift up your name high above the mountaintops, oh God. Even when we're down in the valley lows, oh God, we are ever so thankful to just be able to say Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's no other name that we call. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Strength. Hallelujah. At this time, we are going to just continue with that spirit of worship, but we're going to invite you all to worship in a way that everyone can participate in our giving. We give because of the faithfulness of God to say, thank you, Lord. I know that what I have doesn't belong to me. It belongs to you, and I will be a good steward of all that remains. But with this first fruit of my increase, God, I'm committing it to you. I'm committing it to the work of the kingdom, to the ministry that we have become known as, praying prayerfully and diligently seeking to please God's will. So if you have a check or a money order, you can, or some cash, you can walk it down. And I want us to just give a hand to Millie standing, representing our Action Center Youth Ministry. We thank God because this is where your proceeds are going. We give towards a very rich and enriching curriculum that teaches the children in a way they can understand to love the Lord. If you're paying virtually or digitally, you can also go to Cash App or Givelify or go into our app on Church Center and go ahead and hit the donate button. Go to our website, bicyork.org. Friends and family, we are also putting on so many events for our community, not just those who come in the building, but those who are our neighbors, as the Bible tells us to be good to our neighbors. We do this because of the gifts that you give. Amen. We are able to increase our budgets that go towards making a place of worship that is comfortable and welcoming to everyone. This is God's house, so we ought to use what he has given us for its building. Amen.
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 At this time, I'd also like to welcome Minister Daniel Bishop and his beautiful wife, Benita Bishop, with Amen. Some announcements and some prayer this Amen. Morning.
First and foremost, God, we wouldn't want to just give you reverence, God, in this offering, in this tithes, God. We just pray that you continuously just magnify, God, supply the needs of your people, Lord. We just are grateful for this offering, God, that it will meet the needs of your kingdom, God, and what it is that you have to do for us in such a time as this, God. For those who may not have had that had a heart to give but weren't able to, God, I just pray that you will also meet the needs of them as well, God. And we ask all these things in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, family.
Good morning.
Good morning, family.
Good morning.
Okay.
Good morning.
Don't have me getting up here and acting like it ain't a good morning, because it's got to be a good morning because I'm up here. Amen. Just want to give a few reminders. We got our first annual passion. Okay. So we definitely still need some volunteers. Also for some Easter eggs and baskets. All those who would like to volunteer for that, please see Sister Wendy and Sister Leslie. Amen. Anybody who wants to help out. We had our very own one of our teens this morning who had it on her heart and her vision. Olivia, Sister Olivia, she came in and she brought some stuff that she wanted to fill the eggs with, so we got a jump start. But that's what it's all about, right? Raising our teens to be a servant of the Lord. Amen. Amen. I'm really proud of her, y'all. Really proud. Even though our me and my husband are overseers of the TIC, we call it Teens in Christ Ministry, we really, really are so proud of, even though we don't have many yet, and I do say yet, amen, we will be having many more to come. But what we do have, I'm so proud of them because they're becoming just little soldiers for Christ, amen. So we want to keep lifting them up. Anybody who has friends, children, teens, please let them know they don't have to be a community member, but they can come on over and join us in that morning service, amen.
Amen.
Also, we have the theology conference, okay? Our second one for the upcoming new year, amen. So that will be September the 13th and the 14th. Again, that's September 13th and 14th, our theology conference led by our very own pastor, amen. Also have our first annual auto show. Ran by, amen. Come on. This has been a journey for me, y'all, but I definitely had a brother come on board. My very own brother Floyd, come in Christ, amen. Came at a perfect time. Me and him are running this show. We're going to do an awesome job at it, okay? Amen. So come out and support, please. That's going to be on the 30th, the day before Easter. And we're really looking for a nice turnout. We heard a lot of people in this area and love auto shows, so we're really trying to do our thing, amen. And Women in White, June 1st, amen. Women in White, June 1st. Elder Denise is overseer of that ministry, amen. So we also want to welcome other women to come out. It's not just for women, though. It's for men and women, okay? But we want all the support we can need to come out and be a blessing, amen. That concludes our announcements for this morning. I want y'all all to go and have a blessed day and a blessed week.
Amen. 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 We thank God for all the great things that is happening. We just endeavor not to be idle, but to be active and effective. So continue to keep us in prayer as we hear from the Lord and seek his guidance on all the areas of need and use the gifts he's given us to fill it. Amen. There's nothing like the power of God's love in his people. That's how we know, that's how the world knows that we are his, by the way we love each other. So by participating in events or contributing towards them, that is an act of love. And we appreciate and depend, a lot of times we're depending on your acts of love and your partnering with us. So thank you, and we bless God for his faithfulness. So we are going to just get back into that focus of the Lord, his faithfulness, his goodness, as we are celebrating this Advent season of his resurrection and that sacrifice. There's nobody who was able to take on all of our bad choices and make it okay with God. Nobody but the Lord Jesus Christ. No one except another human being, but who's also had that power of perfection to give that perfect sacrifice. And because of that, we can know that everything we need, every good and perfect thing we need, can come from him. Amen.
Amen.
So this last song is Nobody Like You, Lord. It's a song of a song of worship, of acknowledgement, of adoration. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I hit play already. I was stalling for time. I know you all know this, so please help us out and lift it up to the Lord.
Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name. Your name is strength.
Figure it out that there's no one else who wouldn't serve a God like this. Who wouldn't serve a God like this? And I'll tell you about my God. His name is Healer, Provider, Sustainer. Say yes, say who wouldn't serve a God like this? He's the keeper. Because he heals us and makes us whole.
Who would deserve a God like this?
We love him, we praise him, we serve him, we call him our healer, provider, sustainer. God, and we bless him today. Just put your hands together and receive our pastor. So while our pastor is preparing to come up, thank you, praise team. I just wanted us to acknowledge some birthdays that have happened in March. I know today is Zenai's birthday, so we bless God for him. Let's give him a round of applause. I know they couldn't make it today. But we also are celebrating our pastor, whose birthday just passed, March 15th. We are so grateful for him. This is actually his seventh year pastoring Believers in Christ community. Yeah, wow, brought through by the grace of God. It's a big deal, right? So the Bible calls us to outdo one another in showing honor in Romans 12. And it also allows us the opportunity to be able to tell those who are above us in the Lord all that their obedience has done to impact our lives. It tells us to let them know what their teachings do and all those different things. So while many people might want to celebrate a life at the end, at like a funeral or something like that, we want to celebrate a life that is still living, still going by the grace of God, and still being that example and that message of hope that we get, that hope that we put our anchor in Christ Jesus. So we acknowledge you today. We want to thank you. We want to give you your flowers while you're still alive to smell them. Amen. Many of you have reached out with messages of encouragement and love on Pastor Matthew's birthday, and I was able to get some of them, just some of all of the people whose lives you impact and believers in Christ community. Amen. So we put together this book here of birthday wishes. It's just a big greeting card. It's all it is, right? And I'm just going to share with you all just a message, not all the messages, just this one. Pastor Matthew, over the last 7 years, you've led this ministry with fervor, fidelity, firmness, and fortitude, and faithfulness. A literary adaptation, my favorite. The Bible says, shepherd God's flock among you, not overseeing out of compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you. Not out of greed for money, but eagerly. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. And you preached on that, 1 Peter 5. The Lord who called you, Matthew, and revealed himself to you in order that you would be a believer in Christ, has also paved the path for you to lead. As the Bible admonishes, I urge you to walk worthy of the calling you have received with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. So we celebrate your birthday as those who have benefited from the fruit of your labor and obedience. About fruit, the scriptures say that Jesus himself said, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. And that's out of John 15. So we are celebrating not just you because of the person you are, but because of what God has done through you, because of that burden that you bear by his grace, because we recognize the way you've encouraged us, the way you have given of yourself to us. And blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord and whose confidence in him. So I want to just take this time on behalf of all my brothers and sisters, all the sheep in God's flock that you are shepherding, to say thank you and to thank God for you, for your faithfulness and obedience in ministry since he's appointed it at the time of your birth. So you go ahead and read this book since you love books so much. I'm going to go ahead and secure this for you, but let's just one more time just thank God for him. Let's give him a praise. And so I pray that preaching is easy for you.
Happy birthday. Yeah, come on, guys. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
I'm just appreciative. Whoa. Thank you so much for the birthday, the calls, the texts, the emails, the Facebooks. Okay.
Thank you.
happened. Oh, this one. Okay. It happens after, there we go, when the lights go off. I know it's a little hot. We get in a sec. And I used to be fearful of that before I was in Christ. And as I laid there in the bed, you know, I didn't think it was till death, but I was like, well, you know, if it is, I know that I'll wake up with my Father in heaven. And I knew that, like I was rest assured of that. Like I knew that 100% that if for some reason my eyes closed and did not open on this earth, that when they did open, I would be in the presence of our King. And I was pretty confident in that, not because of anything that I have done, because I haven't done anything, but it's just by the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It was by His grace. Nothing I've done. I haven't done anything. I'm just, you know what I mean? Like Paul said, I'm the chief sinner. Chief sinner so much I had to move. But I had to move to York. In all seriousness, you know, I appreciate y'all. I thank y'all. I know this is an interesting time in the church as we move towards Easter season and as we move towards just finding out what God has for us and what God has us to do as a community, as a body of Christ. And I'm so blessed to sit in the seat of leadership here at this church to lead the body of Christ. Those that are here, those that are online, those that are just part of the community, I am blessed that you all allow me to serve you as your leader. And I truly, truly love you all. From my heart to yours, this is something that I know God has prepared me for my entire life. Even when I was doing things I had no business doing, even before I knew the Lord, I know now that He was always preparing me for this. So I pray that I serve you all well. I pray that that I wash your feet and that I lead that type of way, that 1 Peter chapter 5 leadership, eldership that Peter talked about, suffering with you all and not doing it out of compulsion or lording it over the people of God, but in service. And I pray that's what you all see. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. So enough of that mushy stuff. If you're ready for the word of God, somebody say, I'm ready. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to continue our series, Risen Together. Amen. I don't know if they can hear me on the chat, on the stream. They might now that we got it all squared away. But if you're with me, family, we are in the third installment of this as we move through this series of Lent. Amen. And if you could do me a favor and turn to Luke 14. I'm going to read the 15th through the 23rd verse. Amen. When you have it, do me a favor. Like the old Baptist preacher said, and rest on your feet. I see Sister Jav is ready. Sister Rocky is ready. Brother Ron is ready. Praise the Lord. If y'all would indulge me as well, after service, can I get like the greeting team and the community experience team together for like 3 minutes right after service? We can meet over here just for like 3 minutes. Just want to get with y'all for a second. Luke 14, 15 verse. And I'll read it into your hearing. It goes, when one of those who reclined at the table with him heard these things, he said to him, blessed is the one who will eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then he told him, a man was given a large banquet and invited many. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who were invited, come, because everything is now ready. But without exception, they all began to make excuses. First one said to him, I have bought a field, and I must go out and see it. I ask you to excuse me. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to try them out. I ask you to excuse me. And another said, I just got married, and therefore I am unable to come. So the servant came back and reported these things to his master. Then in anger, the master of the house told his servant, go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the city and bring in here the poor, maimed, blind, and lame. Master, the servant said, what you ordered has been done, and there's still room. Then the master told the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and make them come in so that my house may be filled. For I tell you that not one of those people who were invited will enjoy my banquet. Let's pray, family. Father, in the most matchless and precious name of Jesus, we bless you, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity to gather and hear your word, Lord God. We thank you for the people of God, Lord God, that have assembled here, Lord God, in person and those that are online as well, Lord. I pray today, Lord, that I would not be a stumbling block to your people hearing a message directly from you. I pray today that the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart would be acceptable in your sight, Lord, our strength and our Redeemer, in whom we trust. And let all God's people say amen, amen, and amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. If I were to give you a topic to follow today in this third installment, the Risen Together series, it would be quite simply, there's still room. There's still room. Look to your neighbor and say, there's still room. There's still room. There's still room. Still room. I saw a video the other day, and it was real interesting. It was talking about multiple successful people in the world. And it, one of the things it said was, it was talking about dedication and commitment of the father in these different successful people's lives. I saw one of the people they talked about was Tiger Woods, right? And Tiger Woods being the best golfer to ever play golf, right? And it talked about how his father had told him everything to do as a boy, which led to his success. Talked about Venus and Serena Williams, the greatest tennis players, female tennis players to ever live, and how their father, Richard Williams, right? We even know that everybody saw the movie, right? Right? And everybody know about the slap, right? We all know about that, right? Right? So, yeah, right? Yeah. Some people know more about the slap than they know about the movie. But there was a movie, right? And that Will Smith played Richard Williams, and he told his 2 daughters everything. He made every decision for them as they were coming up. And as they were coming up, they ended up being the greatest female tennis players to ever live. Michael Jackson, the greatest musical performer of our time, was consistently told by his father, Joe, everything to do. Now, these are just a few, and there's countless others, but the point is these people and others have become successful people because their fathers told them everything to do. And there was no excuses tolerated. And the reality of the fact is, if we really think about it, these fathers that raised these children to be extremely successful were all flawed. They were all just men. They all had issues. They all had problems. Tiger Woods' dad, Earl, had issues. The Williams sister, their father, Richard, had issues. And we all know Joe Jackson has some issues. But yet and still with a father who are human, who fathers who had flaws, fathers who had to deal with their own trauma and their own issues, these men raised children into being mega successful by what society would deem as success. And it caused me, as I was watching this, I spiritualized everything. It caused me to think about our spiritual Father in heaven, who exists without flaws, who exists without trauma, who exists outside of time, who knew us before we were even in our mother's wombs, who adopted us as his own before the foundation of the world, who gives us instruction, and oftentimes instead of following his plan for our lives, that his plan, what he says, what he knows is best for us, we oftentimes begin to make excuses. Our Heavenly Father lays out the plan for us. He lays out the plan of success. He says, if you do A, B, and C, you will be with me in glory. You will have a peaceful, you will have a life that maybe every moment won't be peaceful, but you'll have the peace to deal with the unpeaceful moments in your lives. But we oftentimes, we make excuses. I think about probably the Williams sisters, or Tiger Woods, or Michael Jackson, or whoever, right? Whoever we deem successful by society, how many times did they make excuses to their earthly fathers? But oftentimes, when God lays out a plan for us, we figure out a way to do it our own way. The definition Luke uses here in this particular text for excuse, it means to refuse to pay attention to or to avoid. Right? Can you imagine that? Refusing to pay attention to the voice of God in your life. The one who spoke and created the world. The one who spoke things into existence. The one who, you ever realize his voice is not white noise. It is the voice of God speaking directly to us, and oftentimes we avoid his voice to listen to the white noise of the world. And we know excuses are not a new thing. It's part of man's sinful and fallen nature. Excuses started in the garden. Adam said, it was the woman you gave me that caused me to sin. Then the woman said, it was a serpent that told her to eat of the fruit. Moses told God that he was slow of speech, as if God didn't already know. So he tried to make an excuse so he wouldn't have to go before Pharaoh. Aaron told Moses, the people wanted a golden calf, so I just told them to gather up the gold and do it, making excuses. Saul told Samuel, I was afraid of the people, and I obeyed them instead of obeying the Lord's command when God told him to destroy all. Philip said, there's only 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread when Jesus told the disciples to feed the multitude. Since the beginning of time, since the dawn of human creation, there has always been room for us to make excuses. Are you with me, family? So as Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of the living God, is sitting here in his last days on earth. He's sitting at this meal with some Pharisees. And the Pharisees were religious elites, right? They were well-to-do religious elites. And he's sitting with, Jesus is sitting at a meal with them and other elitists from the Jerusalem subculture. And he begins to tell this parable he has in mind. The excuses that mankind has built into their DNA. So what is a parable? as Jesus began to tell his parables, talk about that. A parable is a story or saying that illustrates a truth using comparison, hyperbole, or simile, right? It could be a model, it could be an analogy, it could be an example. And most of Jesus' teachings would come through some sort of a parable. And to fully gain and understand, or to fully understand what a parable is talking about, it is first important for us to understand the social, the cultural, the historical context of the parable, and also to whom Jesus is sharing the parable with. Jesus, at this home, at this meal with the Pharisee, just to set the context, he has, in verses 1 through 6, he has healed a man that was swollen with fluid. Jesus heals him, and then the Pharisees start to look at him crazy because he's healing on the Sabbath. In verses 7 through 14, Jesus then tells a parable of humility, right? Because all these guests at the dinner, they want to sit in the high seats, right? Anybody know what I'm talking about? They want to, you get to a party, you gotta sit in the high seat, right? Everybody wants to sit in the high seat. You know something? We used to have a high seat on the pulpit back in the day, and we took that thing off. No high seats in the pulpit. How the pastor gonna be sitting down? Everything really grinds my gears. Why are you sitting up there to be worshipped? Right? I the only person that should be sitting down in the temple being worshipped is Jesus. Don't need no, like, what you need? Some little funny, fancy Chinese looking seat up there on the pulpit to be sitting on just to make yourself look special. Can't stand it, man. We need to sit amongst the people because we just people. It makes me so upset. It really does. Just sit amongst the people. We're people. We all people. I'm just playing the role of pastor. What makes my role more important than somebody else than the cleaner, than the security, than the usher, than the greeter, than the admin? It's nothing. It all works together. It all works together. So Jesus tells them in verses 7 through 14, he talks to them about being humble, and he talks to them about humility, and that when you're invited, don't take the high seat. Why? Because you get your feelings hurt. You sit in the high seat. Somebody else comes who's of more esteem than you, and then you got to move your seat. You be like, bruh, a seat wasn't for you, fam. That's embarrassing. Imagine that, going to sit up on somebody's pulpit because you think you're fancy and special. You got your little funny collar on. People don't even know what the collar's for, really, right? If you really ask them, most people don't know. But imagine that. You're sitting up there, and then somebody else comes with a bigger, brighter, bigger robe and says, it's time for you to move, right? It's embarrassing. So Jesus, he tells the banquet host and the other cultural elites there that instead, this is the last part of it, instead of inviting the people, the other elitists, the other influential people, instead of throwing a banquet for them, how about you invite the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind? How about you invite these people to your house, right? Why? Because these people could do nothing for you in return. The only reason why you're inviting the elites to your house, the only reason why you're trying to do all this pomp and circumstance, invite all these people to your home, is because you want to have fame in the area. It's actually, as a sidebar, this is what was going on in the Corinthian church. The church, they were inviting people. That's why Paul had to talk about communion, because they were having little dinner parties to invite certain people to their homes so that they could show off their homes and show off their houses. And Paul's like, yo, y'all are creating these little groups instead of having fellowship together. It's the same thing that was going on in the church in Ephesus, which is why Paul had made that statement about the women, because they were inviting people over to the house to show off their pearls, to show off their jewelry, because Ephesus was a port city, so they had a lot of money in Ephesus. So they would want to show off their jewelry and stuff like that. And Paul's like, yo, man, Just invite the people that can't do anything for you, that aren't going to esteem you in the community. Are you with me? And this all plays into Jesus' main teaching here. And in this particular parable that we'll look at, Jesus is using it, he's actually referring to future events of the marriage feast of the Lamb that John wrote about in chapter 19 of the book of Revelation. And this is the backdrop when one of those that are sitting at the meal with Jesus is moved, right? Like he had a shando in his spirit. He was excited about what happened. And he said, blessed is the one who will eat bread in the kingdom of God. Blessed is the one. Why is he saying that? Because as an elitist, as a Pharisee, they felt like they were, what's the word I want to use? Like they felt like there was a seat waiting for them. Like it was all about them. So like, you know, it was sort of like a underhanded way of giving themselves credit. And Jesus will respond to this beatitude with this imagery of Revelation 19 when he tells them that a man was given a large banquet and invited many. So this banquet is happening. Jesus is telling this parable, and he says this, invite certain people. And culturally, what would happen if you were doing a banquet or you were throwing a party, you would send out two invitations. You would send out one invitation to let people know that the party is going on. It's like a RSVP. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody ever been to a wedding or something like that, right? You send out an RSVP. Let me make it plain. You send out an RSVP. The people get the RSVP, and they respond, right? They say, yep, we coming to the party, right? So the man sends out all these invitations to this party, right? And the people say, we're coming, right? So why would they do that? Let me even make it plainer. How many of y'all ever threw a cookout? You know about cookouts? There we go. Let's make it real plain. Cookout. So you want to know who's coming to cookout because you want to know how many hot dogs and hamburgers you about to buy from Walmart. The worst thing you could do is buy an extra box of hot dogs and hamburgers that just end up getting frostbit in the freezer because you didn't use them at the cookout. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Y'all not going to keep it real. Okay. All right. So you want to know how many hot dogs and how many hamburgers you're supposed to have. So similarly, in this culture, they needed to know how big of an animal they needed to slaughter to feed all the people, right? So these people have already agreed to come to this feast. And now at the time when the host sends his servant to let them know that everything is prepared. So I sent you the letter for the cookout. Cookout's ready. You told me you was coming. Time for the cookout. Now when he tells them to come, everybody starts having an excuse. Everybody's got an excuse. Right? Now there's a problem. It's time for the feast to begin. And those that had said they were going to attend have excuses. Look at it, verse 14. It says, but without exception, they all began to make excuses. The first one said, I have bought a field, and I must go out and see it. I ask you to excuse me. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to try them out. I ask you to excuse me. And another said, I just got married, and therefore I'm unable to come. And this brings me to my first point. I got 3 points today, and we're out of here. First point is we can at times become susceptible to putting things before God as if we would have those things without him. At times we can become susceptible to putting things before God as if we would have those things without him. The Bible tells us quite plainly in James 1:17 that every good and perfect gift comes from above, coming down from the Father of lights, meaning you don't have nothing good unless it came from God. You don't have nothing good unless it came from God. These people were invited to this feast. They accepted and now are finding every excuse in the book, and they are trying to do it under the guise of good things that are happening to them. Some theologians actually say that they were misusing some scripture from the Old Testament to justify this. You can look at Deuteronomy 20 for that. But in an honor-shame culture, this would be considered a huge dishonor to the invitee, to the host. Because they said they were coming, they said they were bringing people, and then all of a sudden you dishonor him by not coming. Let me see if I made a play. Let me see, because y'all looking at me funny. You throwing a party, you invite your homegirl and your best friend, and your homegirl and your best friend don't show up. See, some of y'all will never talk to your homegirl or your best friend ever again after that. Okay, let me see if I make it plainer. You sign up for the bowling trip, and then you don't come to the bowling trip. That make it plainer. There we go. Somebody heard me now. There we go. Let's make it plain. Make it real plain. The first two would seem eerily familiar to those present as they were wealthy. This is a wealthy crowd, right? So one bought a field and wanted to see it. The other one, but it would actually be absurdly abnormal for someone to buy a field without ever seeing it. Like, who really buys a house, right? Let's think about nowadays. You're not buying a house without seeing a house, right? Especially in an agrarian culture, you're not buying a field unless you go see the field, because you want to make sure that the field is good for crops, right? The second one said that he had just bought 5 yokes of oxen. Similar excuse to the previous one. These two, what are they doing? They're obviously putting money and business before God. They're putting money and business before an appointed time with God, which is interesting because when you think about it, God gave them the ability to get the money in the first place. Let me see. This is going to be one of them days. Let me make it plain. I can't understand when people get a new job that interferes with their ability to come to church. I don't get it. I mean, I know it's hard sometimes, but it happens because I think we don't take our religious responsibilities with supreme importance. Try to make somebody of the Jewish tradition work on a Saturday. It's not happening. It's not going to happen. Why? Because from the door, before they accept the job, before they accept the position, they're going to say, Saturday is my Sabbath. They're not going to work. They're not going to do it. But for us, we make concessions all the time. And I think if we would from the door, I don't work on Sundays is my day of worship. It's my day of worship. And nothing is going to stop me from participating in my day of worship. We don't see devout Jews working on Saturdays. But for us, it's simple. It's not a big deal because we don't have a true, I think, appreciation for the gathering. And I think a lot of this has happened because of, you know, COVID and, you know, we can go online and stuff. And I'm not against the going online, because sometimes you got to make things happen. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying it in a legalistic way. You know what I'm saying? But what I'm saying is the pattern, right? It creates a pattern. Well, I miss work for church. I'll miss church for work on Sunday. Or I'll miss church now to link up with some friends, right? Or now I'm tired from work, right? So now I'm going to stay home and rest with the family on Sunday. And instead of coming to church as a family, now you say, I'm going to rest with the family. But the crazy thing is you're not really resting with the family, because everybody's in their own room doing their own thing with their face in their own phone, and nobody's even doing anything with anybody in the first place. Am I right or am I right? We gotta tell the truth, shame the devil. Stop using the I'm tired and I worked all week and I'm gonna spend time with my family as an excuse not to come to church on Sunday, because you're not spending time with the family. One of you's watching CBS or on the big screen. You know what I'm saying? The baby's up there watching Coco Melon upstairs on the iPad, because you don't want to be bothered with the baby. So the baby gets to use the iPad all they want for 18 hours a day. Then the teenager's upstairs talking to God knows who on Snapchat, erasing videos so that you can't see it later, all kind of stuff. But then we saying, this is our family time on Sunday. It's like, I mean, am I speaking to somebody? Like, am I keeping it real? It's not family time when everybody's in their own room on their own phone. And I think it's the same thing with this third excuse. The other one said in verse 20, he said, and another said, I just got married, therefore I'm unable to come. See, the thing is, some of us, or some, I'm not going to say any of us, because nobody here would do it. But some put possessions over Jesus, and others put people over Jesus. How many husbands allow their relationship with their wife to come between them and God? Or how many wives have allowed their relationship with their husbands to come between them and God? How many other relationships do we put before God? We get a new boo, all of a sudden everything changes. Children, all of a sudden we put our children before God, which we are not to idolize our children, right? We got to take care of our aging parents, so we put that before going to church on Sunday. Family in general, forsaking God to do things for and with your family as if God is willing to play second fiddle to your family. When Jesus said, quite plainly, he said, the one who loves a father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He said, the one who loves a son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And it's real. It's in the red letters. But this is not about a lack of love. It's about prioritizing the things of God. Are y'all with me? Verse 21, so the servant came back and reported these things to the master, all these excuses. And then in anger, the master of the house told his servant, go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the city and bring in here the poor, the maimed, the blind, and the lame. So the master of the house gets angry, right? And this is, again, this is a parable, right? This brings me to my second point. God can display righteous anger when we don't prioritize him. God can and will display righteous anger when we don't prioritize him. God becomes angry with us when we don't give him the proper place in our lives. Look what the psalmist wrote. He wrote, God, you have rejected us. You have broken us down. You have been angry. Restore us. The prophet wrote, Zechariah, the Lord was extremely angry with our ancestors. It's a public insult for us to pronounce our relationship with God, but not allow that relationship with God to take primary place in our hearts. It's a public insult to God. Public insult. How do we feel in a relationship when we get rejected? Think about it. How do we feel? You just, you know what I'm saying, your husband, the boo, whatever. You call him up. I want to talk to you. You know what I'm saying? Y'all know how y'all do it. I want to talk real quick, but they ain't got no time for you. How do you feel? How do you feel? You feel slighted. You feel wronged. You feel abused. You feel taken advantage of. You feel not unloved. You feel like, well, what did I do? Why I can't get love? Why you can't invest time in me? You invest time here. You do this. You do that. But you got no time for me. How do you think God feels? Who is the author of everything and is the author of all emotions? How do you think God feels when he calls us and we don't answer the phone? Or when God calls us and we say, man, I got to get to work, though. I got other things I got to do. I got to go work out. I got to take the kids to this. I got to go do this. I got to go do that. I got to run here. I got to run there. And we never give God his proper place in our lives. And it's a public insult, because what it is if that's what we do, those that are in the know, that are supposedly know God and have a relationship with God, what are we showing to others? What are we showing what a relationship with God looks like. And in a season where God is, where we are looking at the resurrection, in a season where we get to celebrate the resurrection and we get to talk about the goodness of Jesus Christ, what does it look like when we don't put Jesus first in our lives, but then we want to go tell somebody else that don't know nothing about Jesus that you should put Jesus first in your life? I think it's very important, because sometimes you ever get, and I'm not going to say like God or like he does chastise us, but like you ever sometimes you think you get blessed with something and then all of a sudden the blessing starts to stress you out. Like you thought it was good, but then it ends up not being what you thought it was. Like you thought the promotion was a blessing, but then something in your spirit felt off, right? Or you thought like that this was the beginning of a new relationship, but then you as you were working through that relationship, something in your spirit fell off, right? You didn't feel that financial increase that you thought the promotion was gonna give you. Like for some reason, even though you got this financial increase, you still got more month at the end than money. The scripture tells us that the blessings of the Lord make rich, but add no sorrow. And I think sometimes what happens is that we think things are blessings, or we maybe it even was a blessing, but then we mishandle it. So when I played football, right? So there was a season, somebody gonna laugh, but there was a year when I was like the backup quarterback. Like I was the running back, and I played strong safety, running back, and corner. I was a BC. I played in college too, I was a beast. I didn't even go front, you know what I'm saying? I used to come down off that cover one and light them running backs up, man, and you know what I mean, the flat. But that's a whole nother story for another day. I do got tape, but when you play quarterback, there's a handoff, there's an exchange of the ball. So when the quarterback would call a play, like back in the day, we used to run like I formation, right? Like, this new school football is weird to me, man. But like, you would run the ball. And there was an exchange between the quarterback and the running back. And the quarterback would have to put the ball in the pocket of the running back. It's an important exchange. And the way you had your hands, like if you were running to the right side, as a running back, your left hand should be up, right hand down. If you're running to the left side, right arm up, left hand down, so that you create this pocket here. But what happens is, it's similar to the quarterback handing the ball to the running back. God hands us blessings. And sometimes because we don't have our hands in the proper position, we fumble the blessing. Sometimes because we weren't prepared to get the ball, because we weren't prepared to take the ball and move forward, we dropped the ball. Or maybe because we were looking forward and not looking at where the ball was being placed, we dropped the ball. And God has some blessings for us that I think some of us have forgotten, that it is God that is giving us the ball, and it's God that is encouraging us to run. And we just think that we're the ones that we hiked the ball, we handed the ball off to ourselves, we ran down, threw the ball to ourselves, scored a touchdown all by ourselves. And we forget that it is God that is leading us, God that is allowing us to be blessed, God that is handing the blessing on to us and over to us, that we can run with it. So in response to the people who had originally accepted the invitation not coming, the host told the servant to go into the streets and alleys and the city and compel others to come. Theologian Dow Bach, he writes, this is the crux of the parable I'm quoting. He says, the original invitees represent Israel. Although the nation as the originally invited is not responding, the time for the arrival of the kingdom has come, and the initial celebration of his blessings will go ahead. Others previously thought excluded from the celebration will now get invitations, end quote. There's an old saying that goes, like, one man's garbage is another man's treasure. You know what I'm talking about? Me and Sister Kathy was talking about this yesterday at the Kingdom Men in Black about, like, you know, when you go to, like, a what do you call those things? When people got the tables out and stuff, like yard sales, right? Or even if you look at Facebook Marketplace, people, they'll have for signs up of things that are for free outside their homes, right? Because one person rejects something doesn't mean that that thing has lost value. Did you hear what I said? Don't miss that. Just because one person rejects something doesn't mean that it has lost value. So because Israel rejected the blessings of God and the favor of God and God's Messiah, doesn't mean that God's blessing or God's favor or God's Messiah loses any value. But because Israel rejected and did not accept the invitation, the Gentile world, us, those who are, what are Gentiles? Those who are not Jews, right? Those who are in the Jewish mind, the world is broken up into Jews and Gentiles. You got those that are Jewish by birth, and you got those who are Gentiles, non-Jewish by birth. And then you have what's called a proselyte, someone that becomes Jewish. But the Jewish world is broken up in two ways. And because Israel rejected God, God said, I'm going to bring in a sheep that were not my own into my fold. This is why Paul writes, quoting the prophet Hosea. He says, I will call not my people, my people, and she who is unloved, beloved. And it will be in the place where they were told, you are not my people. They will be called sons of the living God. Paul then writes in Romans 11, he says, on the contrary, by their transgression to Israel, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel jealous. And then John, he wrote, he came to his own, speaking of Jesus, and his own people did not receive him, but to those who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God. God has a special place for Israel based on his promise to Abraham. And I want y'all to understand that this is important. Don't get it twisted. The church has not replaced Israel. Understand this. The church has not replaced Israel. In our eschatology, it teaches us that there are two different end times, right? In our end times study, it shows there are two different plans. There's a plan for Israel. There's a plan for the church. The church does not cancel out the promise God made to Israel and to Abraham in Genesis chapter 15. It doesn't. But what the church must do in response to this grafting in that Paul talks about, he uses the imagery of grafting in to an olive tree in Romans 11, is we have one job, and that is we must spread the gospel. We must spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And those of us that have been into the Bible study, we know what the gospel of Jesus Christ is. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is written out plainly in 1 Corinthians 15, right? It says it right there that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is what we are to be spreading and sharing with others. It's quite plain, it's quite simple. I'll rewind it and say it again, that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures. What scriptures? The Old Testament scriptures. It's written all about them. In the Old Testament, Jesus Christ is concealed. In the New Testament, Jesus Christ is revealed. But he died according to the scriptures for our sins, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, according to the scriptures. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this brings me to my last point, and then my third point of the day, and we out of here. The gospel makes room at the table. The gospel makes room at the table. There's room at the table because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have to begin to share the gospel. We have to know what the gospel is. If we are call ourselves saved and knowing Jesus and can't articulately explain what the gospel is, then what are we really doing? We need to know that what Jesus did was for all mankind, that he suffered, that he died, that he was buried, that he rose 3 days later, that we may have life, life everlasting with the
Father. It is the gospel of Jesus Christ, that Jesus came to this earth and died for our sins according to the scripture. What is sin? Sin is transgressing the will of God. We've talked about this in Bible study. We talk about this. Why? So that we can know, so that as we go out and as we are compelling people to come, we're compelling people to come to a true gospel, not a false one. That Christ died for our sins according to the Old Testament scriptures. This is the gospel message, the declaration of independence from the kingdom of this world into the freedom of the kingdom of God. It's the power, Paul says, it's the power unto salvation. He says, Paul, talking about salvation, how do we know one is saved? How do we know to be saved? If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. This is the gospel. So when it tells us to go out to the highways and the byways, when it tells us to go into the streets and the alleys and compel them to come, you're not compelling them to come to church. We're not compelling people to come to a social group. We're not compelling people to come to a social gathering. We're compelling people to come to Jesus. It's about Jesus. It's the gospel that somebody died for your sins, paid the price for what we couldn't pay, paid the price for the things we did. Where are the older siblings at? Any older siblings in here? I'm the old. Okay, older siblings. You'll ever take the blame for one of your younger siblings for something they did? You probably still didn't get paid back for it. That's what our older sibling, Jesus Christ, did for us. He took the punishment that we deserve. This is the gospel that should be brought to all mankind. And for God, he wishes that none would be saved, that none would perish. But he has a very, very special place in his heart for the marginalized. He said, go into the streets. What's the streets? The wide, popular place in town, right? It's where communication and dialogue takes place, right? The streets, the city, the street or the city square, it was instantly accessible to everybody. It was visually and audibly accessible to everybody. What Jesus is saying through this parable is go into the streets. Don't be a secret agent. When I used to run my insurance agency, I would tell people, don't be a secret agent. Don't be a closet agent. The people that live on your street should know that you're an insurance agent. The people that live around you should know that you sell insurance. Do the people that live around us know that we're Christians? Do the people that know us know that we serve Jesus? Do the people that we live near, that we are proximity with, that we go to work with, that we shop with, that we do community with, do they know that we love Jesus? Do they know that God spared our lives through his grace? Do we let them know, or are we closet Christians? Are we closet, or are we just Christians on Sundays? He said, go into the alleys. What's the alleys? The alleys are narrow path between hedges and fences. Think about the community. Think about homes. Think about neighborhoods. He said, go to the and compel who to come? The poor, the maimed, the blind, the lame. Compel them to come. Jesus said this at the onset of his ministry. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. He stood up in the midst of the synagogue and said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach the good news. What is gospel? The gospel is the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the oppressed, to set free the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. This is what Jesus came to do. These are our neighbors. These are those that we should be compelling to come. Love God with all your heart. Love God. I love your neighbor as you love yourself. Are we going into the streets, to the alleys? Are we compelling the people to come? Are we sharing the gospel accurately with those who come? Are we sharing the YouTube pastor gospel that just tells you everything's going to be all right? You the greatest thing since sliced bread. God loves you and nobody else. Or do we share the true gospel of Jesus Christ? God came for the sick, the hurt, the lost, the angry, those with hardened hearts, those with past traumas. We can't turn our backs on them. We must care for the widows, the orphans, the single mothers. The prophet wrote, learn to do what is good, pursue justice, correct the oppressor, defend the rights of the fatherless, plead the widow's cause. When we stand for justice, righteousness, and peace for all mankind, will we do the things that God has called us to do? It's time to go out. It's time to compel them to come. Paul wrote, he said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel. That's pride in Christ. It's okay to have pride in Christ. I know pride is one of them ugly words. We act like we don't want to utilize, but right. It's okay to have pride in Christ and for the work that he did on the cross. He said, for it's the power. What power? It's the power to save, Romans 10:13. It's the power to sustain, John 6:37. It's the power to satisfy, John 14:27. And then it's also unto salvation. We get pardoned from all the things we've ever done that has kept us from God. All the things we've ever done that has kept us from God. It is a pardoning, right? A pardoning, meaning I know you did it, but I'm going to still let you off the hook because of the grace of God. I'm going to close with this. There was a story, it probably was like 10 years ago. And there was a young man that wanted to be successful. So he talked to this uber successful man and said, what is the key to being successful? And the guru said to the young man, he said, if you want to be successful, meet me here at the beach tomorrow morning, 6 a.m., and I'll show you what success looks like. So the young man, he puts on his suit and tie the next day, wakes up all fresh and early, excited. He goes and meets the man at the beach. He sees that the man is actually standing in the ocean. So he goes to the beach, and the man says, come into the ocean. So the young man goes into the ocean, and he stands there with the guru, and he asks the guru, he said, what do I need to do to be successful? And the guru grabs the young man in his suit and all and forces his head under the water. And he pushes him and drags him under the water. And the young man he's wailing his arms. He can't breathe. He's wailing. He's trying to get up. He can't breathe. He's trying to forcefully get the guru off from the guru. Is holding him down under the water. He can't breathe. He's starting to like drink the salt water. It's almost till death. And then at the last second, the very last second, the guru pulls him out of the water. And the guru says to the young man, what is it that you wanted the most? And the young man said, I wanted to breathe. He said, when you want success, like you want to breathe, then you'll be successful. So watch this. It's easy to say, I want Jesus like I want to breathe. If you know Jesus, if you've been there, if you've tasted Jesus, it's easy to say that. Like, yeah, I want Jesus like I want to breathe. Am I right or am I right? But how easy is it to say, I want my neighbor to have Jesus like I want to breathe? I want the person that I don't know, that doesn't know Jesus, I want them to have this feeling that I have, like I need to breathe. When we feel compelled to share the gospel with others, like we can't breathe, only then will true evangelism begin to take place. Only then will strongholds in the area begin to take place. Only then will witchcraft begin to bow down in this area to Jesus Christ. Only then will the Spirit of the Lord begin to dwell in this place and in this vicinity like never before. But it's going to take a group of people saying, I know I got Jesus for myself, but I want the person that don't got Jesus to know Jesus. I want the witch that don't know Jesus to get Jesus. I want the lame and the poor and the addicted and the afflicted to get Jesus like I got Jesus. But you got to want to do it like you need to breathe. And when you feel compelled to do that, it's easy to show up. When you feel compelled to do that, it's easy to knock on doors. When you feel compelled to do that, it's easy to not lift your nose up at people. It's easier to do that when you realize that other people need Jesus just as much as we do. That's where I'm challenging us to go. That's where I'm challenging us to go as a church, as a body. Okay, you got Jesus. That's great. We'll see you in paradise. I'm assured of that. But why go there by yourself? What about the single mom that doesn't know Jesus? What about the single dad that lost everything? That's questioning Jesus. What about the family that's got kids and they got ball games and cheerleading and everything on Sunday? They don't come to church. What don't they need Jesus? What about the person that walked away because of past trauma? What about the person that was raped and said, Jesus must not love me because I was raped? What are we going to do for those people? Are we going to love them into... Who are we praying into the kingdom? We ask God for our, God, touch me. God, do this. God, give me. God, can I have? God, will you? God, yes. God, please. God, do this for me. God, do this. Who are we praying into the kingdom? The Muslim. What Muslim are we praying in the kingdom? What Hebrew Israelite are we praying in the kingdom? What atheist are we praying into the kingdom? Who are we praying into the kingdom? I know we're not there, and I'm about to get out of here. I know it's late. But I refuse for us to create programs that program us out of Jesus. Breakfast is good. Sunday school's good. Easter party, Easter eggs, all that stuff is good. Concerts, good. Men in Black, Woman in White, all that is good. But the goal is to go compel the lost to come. It's not about preaching to the choir. Like, what's the point of leaving the four walls of this church to go to the four walls of another church to minister to people that already know Jesus and call it outreach? Just because you're outside of the four walls of this church don't mean it's outreach. It just means you're going to minister to other people that know Jesus in somebody else's church. It's not outreach. Or you could figure out ways to compel the people to come. You know when it's outreach? When you're outside. That's when it's outreach. It's not outreach going to somebody else's church to sing and dance in front of people that know what you're singing and dancing is about. It's about compelling the lost. And so what I'm doing... I think I said this here or I said it somewhere. I don't remember where I was at. But I'm going to stop the talking. And I'm going to start putting the action in. Because I'm tired of the talk. So next Wednesday, next Saturday, we are getting ready for the following week to do our Easter event. Right? We get the Easter car show coming up. Sister Benita has been working on that. Brother Floyd's been helping out with that. Saturday next week, I'm going outside. I'm taking flyers, I'm taking quarter waters, I'm taking juice, I'm taking chips, and I'm going knocking on doors. And I'm going to compel them to come. And what I'm asking is I know there's a discipleship group going on next week, and that's fine, but anybody else that would like to connect, or if you want to connect after the discipleship group, however it is, we work it out. 10 o'clock here on Saturday. If you meet me here, We'll go out together. We'll go out together. Because it's time to compel the people to come. I got Jesus, but I need to give somebody else Jesus. Like, I can't breathe right now. That's my heart. That's my heart. So I pray that we lock arms next Saturday, or this Saturday, 10 a.m. Let's come here. Let's meet. Let's go out. Let's be prayed up. And let's go out. Let's put on our BIC gear. And those that want to lock arms with us, let's lock arms. Let's knock on some doors. There's this big community right here, right in the borough. There's another community over here. There's another community over there. It's time. What are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? Because somebody died today. Somebody died today that didn't know Jesus. And I pray that God didn't hold them to our account. Because somebody died and is not going to paradise. Eternal judgment. And I'm not going to preach doom, gloom, despair, and all that kind of stuff. But it's the reality. Amen? Let's focus on evangelizing. Let's focus on outreach. Let's focus on compelling those to come. Are you with me, family? Amen. Let's stand on our feet and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Praise God. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless you, Lord. We thank you and we honor you for your goodness, your mercy, your peace, your love, oh God. And Lord God, we ask you, Lord, to give us that burning desire, Lord, to compel those to come, Lord. Lord, like Jeremiah said, it was like fire shut up in his bones, oh God. I pray today, Lord, that you will give us that fire in our bones to share and spread this gospel, Lord. That, Lord God, that what we, this the Jesus we carry, the Holy Spirit, Lord, we want to help others see Jesus. We want to help others get this freedom in Jesus. You said it's not by might, it's not by power, but it will be by your Spirit. God, endow us with your Spirit, Lord God. Sanctify us and set us apart, Lord God, for the work that you have called us to do, oh God. Lord, let us be willing and able to go outside. For those that can, Lord, I pray that you would cover us now. Those that are going, Lord God, those that are compelled to go, Lord God, to go reach the lost. Go let them know that we are here to support, that we are here to serve. Lord God, I pray, Lord, that you would cover us right now, Lord. Lord, put a reef of protection around us. Lord, cover us with your son's blood, oh God, as we go out to compel your people to come see you. We compel your people to have a relationship with you. We're not calling them to believers in Christ. We're calling them to Jesus, Lord God. We're calling them to know who you are, oh God. So, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would strengthen us, oh God, where we are weak, oh God. I pray that you would fortify us, oh God, if there's any cracks in the walls, oh God. I pray that you would give us a stern and strong foundation, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Have your way, oh God. Lord God, for the positions, Lord God, for the seats that we need filled, Lord, I pray that you would fill them, Lord God, with people willing and ready to work, oh God. I pray right now, Lord God, that, Lord, I know the gifts are in the house, oh God. So, Lord God, I pray that we would just push a little bit more, oh God. Lord God, that we would try a little bit more, oh God, that we would go the extra mile just a little bit more, oh God. I know some of us travel from far to get here, but Lord God, I pray that you would give us the unction, Lord God. Lord, put that extra seed in the account, the extra gas money for them, oh God. I've seen you do it before, oh God. Lord God, give them the extra ambition, oh God, to come and serve, oh God. Lord God, it is your people that need to hear your word, oh God. Lord God, there are sick that need to be healed, oh God. There are traumatized, Lord God, that need to know you, oh God. There are generations, Lord, that are being lost, oh God. And Lord God, we know, oh God, that you are the truth, oh God. We know that you are the solution, oh God. So Father, in the name of Jesus, oh God, we ask that you would solve the problems. We ask that you would solve the issues, oh God. Lord God, we cast all of our burdens on you, oh God. oh God, those things that have been keeping us down from serving you, oh God, the sin that has been weighing us down, the burdens that have been weighing us down, Lord, we cast it upon you. Lord God, you said cast your cares on you because you care for us, oh God. Lord God, you said that your yoke was light and easy, oh God. So Lord God, we pray for that light and easy burden, oh God, that Lord God, that we would not be held down, Lord God, by the traumas in our life, oh God. We would not be held down and burdened, oh God, by our failures, oh God. But Lord God, you have forgiven us of all our sins. You have given us a second chance on life, oh God. And Lord, we want to share this with others, oh God. Lord, you said that if the people didn't cry out, the rocks would cry out. Lord, we don't need any rocks crying for us over here, oh God. We're going to cry out to you, Lord. We're going to do the work of an evangelist, oh God. We're going to spread the gospel, Lord God. We're going to spread your truth, oh God. Lord God, we're not going to bear a false witness, oh God. Our character is going to line up with what we say, oh God. Our character, our heart that has been changed and has been transformed is going to line up with what you say, oh God, so that when we speak, oh God, we will speak with power and conviction, oh God. And Lord God, if they don't receive it, we'll dust our feet off, oh God. Dust off our feet and move to the next one, oh God. Lord God, we pray today, oh God. Lord, you took the world with 12, oh God. I count more than 12 in here today, oh God. I know there's more than 12 online, oh God. Lord God, we can take this community with who is standing in here today, oh God. We can take it for you, oh God. Lord, it's not by accident that you've given us real estate in this area, oh God. You said to take it back, oh God, in the name of Jesus, Lord. You said to take it and claim it in Jesus' name. So, Lord, we pray today, Lord, fortify us, oh God. Fortify us in your gospel truth. Lord, as we prepare to do what it is that you've called us to do. We're going to go to the businesses. We're going to go to the homes, oh God. We're going to go to the parks, oh God. We're going to meet and greet the people, oh God, and just tell them about a man named Jesus, Lord. That has a life everlasting in his hands, oh God. Father, we bless you, Lord. We thank you and we honor you today. In Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord. I'm just going to say, if anybody desires prayer right now, I just feel like the church needs prayer. That this is a moment where those that are struggling to feel compelled to carry on, need prayer. And if you desire prayer, I just want to invite you to the altar right now. That we can pray, that we can touch and agree. Praise God as we prepare for what God has for our next. I know some feel burdened. I know some feel down. But I'm here to tell you now that Jesus is looking at you. Jesus loves you. Jesus cares for you. And Jesus is going to empower you until your next. The altar is open. If you desire prayer, we are here for you today. My God.